Welcome back to Bowls Victoria's live stream coverage of the 2016 Vic Open. It's Remembrance Day. It's 11th of the 11th.
Age shall not rule them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. Thank you, bowlers.
A moment to pause, a moment to reflect and remember those who fell to make this country what it is today. Remembrance Day, the 11th of the 11th. Welcome back to our live stream coverage of the 2016 Victorian Open from Greater Shepparton. Coming up for you now, we have the mixed pairs final. And a fantastic game in progress between husband and wife team. Julie Ross from the Bendigo area. Julie plays for Golden Square. Ian for Bendigo. Against Sharon Steele from the ACT. And Michael Sims, a former Tasmanian who's playing his pennant bowls with Melbourne these days. Michael is a Tasmanian, it should be pointed out. He still is. He just plays his pennant bowls here. And we know that a lot of people in Tasmania are watching our live stream coverage to catch up with Michael's progress and that of another Tasmanian, Lee Schrainer, who will be going around in a couple of finals later in the day. For those who didn't catch our coverage this morning of the triples, our men's triples, first two finals have been decided. Men's triples final, team skipped by Nick McIntyre, winning the men's triples final over Dane McKinnon's team. And Miles beating Kelly McCarrahan in the women's triples finals. We have our first two champions. And here, the mixed pairs has just got underway. My name's Guy Hand. It's a pleasure to welcome in Daniel Nichols from 98.5 1 FM Shepparton, who's been doing a great job with the co-commentary. Daniel, this should be a fantastic match in progress.
Yes, we're really looking forward to this one. It's great to see all the people jumping online, sending in their tweets, because Michael Sims here, he's playing in the mixed pairs. We've also got Lee Schrainer. They're both from Tasmania, and a lot of people are basically barracking for them online, so just send in your tweets, and you can also win a set of aero bowls. We've got three to give away, and we'll be announcing the winners at around about halfway between the men's singles final at the end of the afternoon.
The Super's given us away there. We'd be lucky enough, Mark Cowan, the Victorian under 18 coach, and a man who knows Michael Sims very well, will be joining us a little bit later for our commentary. He'll be coming in at some point during this game. Knows Michael Sims very well as the NTC coach. He's had a lot to do with Michael's development. That's a fantastic bowl, Sharon Steele. Now, a little bit about the bowlers involved in this. Julie Ross putting down bowl. Julie and Ian, husband and wife. Julie, one of the most accomplished bowlers in Victoria. She's a multiple state champion. She's a multiple Victorian representative. And you can see why with bowls like that. Fantastic player. Ian, her husband, part of the Victorian over 60 side, which won the senior sides championships in Western Australia a few weeks ago. Sharon Steele from the ACT, from the Western Creek Wildcats. Hello to everyone in Canberra who may be catching up with this on their live stream. And Michael Sims, one of the most accomplished young bowlers in the country, from Tasmania, plays his pennant bowls at the Melbourne Bowling Club in the Taylor Bowls Premier Division. Daniel's certainly off to a rousing start here.
Yeah, the standard's already high. This is a great mixed pairs game. They've both came off very, very good wins and close games, of course. But when you look at the two pairs, they're both very accomplished bowlers. They've all, of course, won club championships and even state events. And majority of them are state representatives. And I think here Michael Sims and Sharon Steele together as a pair most obviously are going to be the favourites going into this game. What do you think?
They've had a really good run through, and it's interesting to see some of the people that Sharon and Michael have beaten on their way through. In the sectionals, they had a very, very difficult sectional, beating Suzanne Tyson and Barry Ansett, who's a very accomplished arm bowler, 18-12. Bev and Kevin Thorne, 22-5. And then they beat, in probably a little bit of a surprise, Brenda McMaster-Smith and Safwan Saeed, 18-9 in the sectionals.
There you go, there's some massive games, and they've got through.
They have, and then in the quarters, Faye Clark and Graham Spencer, 19-6 in the semi, and Draffin and Stuart Hedger in a very, very tight semi-final last night, 17-14, to win their way into the final against Julie and Ian Ross.
Now, we know that Sims has an incredible drive on him, Guy. I'm sure Mr. Cowan's going to tell us about how well he's developed that, but it's pretty scary when he gets on that mat and when he lets it rip.
In a mixed pairs game, that's also an interesting dynamic, I suppose, because that sort of drive is it's certainly uncommon in women's bowls.
Yeah, it's definitely, and I'll be honest, there's still a lot of respect with the mixed pairs events, and some guys even tone it down a little bit just in respect for the ladies, because a lot of ladies don't like those big powerful drives, and you find that when they're playing with each other they still go full power, but they might even tone it down just a fraction.
It's interesting. Ian Ross here as part of our Victorian over 60s team, which has just won the National Senior Sides Championship in West Australia, at Osborne Park in West Australia. Ian was absolutely in phenomenal touch. Ian was absolutely phenomenal touch. Best skip of the tournament. A really, really good bowler. Spent many years playing at Bundoora in Melbourne.
So as you can see there, Ross and Ross, the husband and wife duo, they've got the red stickers. Or should I say pinky red stickers? Yeah, they're red. And then Steele and Sims have got the white ones. So it looks like the two Rosses have got the two shots here. Sims is going to try and convert. Here we go. Straight up the guts.
Whoa. You weren't kidding about the drive, were you?
I've seen him do it faster than that.
That was still pretty quick, though. If he's toning it down, wow.
Well, they've got two. So the Rosses get off to a good start.
Off to a good start, Ross and Ross. Two up. against Sharon Steele and Michael Sims. Let's take you through what Julie and Ian Ross have done in the tournament so far. In the sectionals, beating Pat Virtue and Andrew Wright 17-7. Marge Ratcliffe and Spencer Ashman, 15-14, a tight one there in the sectionals, got through it. And Deborah and Adrian Bates, 13-9 in the sectionals. In the quarters, very, very interesting. Again, a narrow win, one-shot win over Claire Sanders and Gary Sanders. Now, Claire Sanders is already a Victorian Open champion. She was part of the winning women's triples team just a few minutes ago here. Saw them off in the quarters and in the semis. The very accomplished Roma Opie and Paul McInnes, a bowler you know very well, Daniel, saw them off 16-9.
Yeah, that was Paul McInnes and Roma. They went a long way in this Victorian Open. I think they're very proud of what they've done. But, of course, yeah, Ian Ross, that would have been a tough game for both people there. They played last night. And I got a little bit of feedback from Paul McInnes, and he said he's very proud of what he's actually done and how far they've gone. But he just came up against a tough opponent.
He's a terrific bowler in the Goulburn Valley area. For those who don't know, Daniel is involved. He's the voice of bowls in the Goulburn Valley area, hosts the Bowl Show here on 98.5 1 FM on a Saturday morning, along with Brian Nisbet. One of the best radio programs on bowls anywhere in the country. It's well worth you tuning in if you can't. You can listen online to that.
Great bowl here. A nice set of bowls there. Nice draw, wasn't it?
Very
just
nice.
Just came in really nicely.
Sharon Steele has certainly bought game. I love Julie Ross's delivery. I've noticed this at state champions and state championships as well. Her delivery, one knee down. Very methodical delivery.
Now I'm playing nearly a maximum length, we're probably only about a metre off the tee. Yeah, I see there, Guy, as she just drops that knee. And she's got good posture, though, good balance.
She is a wonderfully balanced bowler. It's the one thing you notice about Julie, and we see her competing in a lot of state championship events, inevitably winning a lot of them. We see her at State Champions Week in Bendigo every year. And it's a famous delivery. It's pretty easy to spot. Along with the ever-present hat.
You don't see so many of those hats left.
Yeah, it's ever-present with Julie, and it certainly stands her out.
They've both got one. So pretty open head here to start the second end. Scores are 2-0. Only one bowl close. You've got three about 6 foot behind and two about 5 foot short. Only early days. See if Ian Ross can change that up a bit and build ahead. Done a pretty good job of it. Yeah, good bowl.
Ian coming off terrific form at the national sides, the National Senior Sides Championship. So he'll be confident going into this. He's played very, very high standard bowls in WA. Part of a state team success.
Yeah, Sims has put in a ripper of a bowl there. They're holding two shots. I was going to say, it looks narrow, but he's got plenty of weight, so he's trying to play through it. And you just missed that, but the bowler actually bumped up. Hit out Sharon Steele's bowl. And now Sims and Steele combination are only holding one. I think Sims has just lacked a little bit of weight here. Ross has changed over. He's played his forehand. A little bit of a running shot here. He's running up the green. He's got it. What a bowl. That's excellent to watch.
Shot. He's certainly continuing his form on from the National Senior Sides Championship. Wow. Impressive.
Yeah, it was a terrific bowl. He played it perfectly. Now Sims is going to have to try and, I believe, play his backhand. And he's going to have to try and creep in there. Just on draw weight. Don't think he's got the legs. Oh, needs to hurry. Gee, that's a good try. Finding take one out.
Yeah, they're all finding their rhythm, finding their range nice and early.
Yeah, nice and early. We've already got a good head, and we're going into the third end.
Just a reminder to everybody that we're offering three sets of aero bowls as a prize in our competition, which we're running in conjunction with the live stream here at Bowls Victoria. Send us your tweets via our Twitter account. It's at Bowls Victoria. Use the hashtag 2016 Vic Open, and we will be giving a prize to the three best tweets as judged by our panel. We'll be announcing that during the men's singles final, which is brings down the curtain on a great Vic Open. That should be kicking off around 6 p.m. tonight. So get on Twitter. Tell us what you think.
Pretty handy start there. Only a foot behind.
Coming out nicely for Sharon at the moment, aren't they?
Yeah, very good. It's a good bowl here by Julie.
Oh, terrific.
Yes, great. Now, Sharon's already had one pretty close. Just try to replicate that, but only a foot short, not too far away. The Rosses are set up pretty well here, I believe. They've got one on it, and they've got two behind. So, if Sharon can get one in between these bowls, it gives a shot on for Sims. So the crowd's building up there, Guy.
Yeah, it's looking terrific, and we're hoping to have a really big crowd by the time we get into our singles matches. Got five more finals to go on finals day. This is the mixed pairs final. We have the men's and women's pairs coming up later in the day, followed by the blue ribbon events, women's singles final, followed by the men's singles final. They'll be played simultaneously. We will be televising both on our live stream coverage here at Bowls Victoria.
Bit unlucky there. He tried to get the inside of it, of course, and maybe trail the jack bat just to make it hard for Michael to get at, but unfortunately got the wrong side of the bowl. can nearly predict what the bowler's going to do by the facial expressions of the bowler. You can tell he didn't like it. He's only 2 foot short though. Good try by Ross. The only problem with that weight is directly on the right, like if that purple bowl gets touched, that jack's going straight back to the other purple bowl. So I believe, and now it's going straight back there as well. So any contact with that purple bowl is still going to be down.
Now Ian Ross taking a really good look at this.
Straight on the mat, chucks it down, a little bit of weight.
What Sim's got to do here?
It's a bit hard to see the head the way it's set up at the moment. Like he's holding one shot. He's got about 2 foot to draw. I reckon it's just a dead draw shot. Doesn't want him to make too much contact with the purple. He could go down. Yeah, just a dead draw. Trying to add another one into the head. Just a bit short. But they get away with one shot.
So they're on the board. Ross and Ross leading Steele and Sims 3-1. Three ends down. Pleasure at this time to welcome into our coverage our special guest commentator, the National Training Centre's coach and Victorian under 18 coach Mark Cowan. Mark, great to have you back again.
Yeah, thanks Guy. Thanks for having me back.
You must have enjoyed it last night. You come back for more.
yeah, it's always nice watching good games.
Now you have a fair insight into one of the players here, particularly in Michael Sims. He's a player that's been on your radar and part of your watch with the NTC.
Yes, Michael's in my NTC squad over in Tasmania, and I suppose I've been working with him for the last 3 years now. And look, he's a prodigious talent. He sometimes loses, like most of the young blokes, they lose their cool if things go against them sometimes. But if he can keep that under control, he's a very, very good talent coming up. So. Certainly on the national radar for the Australian squad anyway, so. He has been given all the accolades to his lead over the course of this week, so, and Sharon's daughter, Kristen's in my Victorian squad, so, it's all a little bit in the family with me, so it's great.
Well, we know Kristen very well. She's a very accomplished bowler in this neck of the woods. You see a fine bowl from Julie Ross there.
I know Ian and Julie fairly well over the years as well. I've played a lot of bowls against Ian, and they're a very solid combination. So,
both in great form too. We've been talking about Ian being part of the National Senior Sides winning team in Osborne Park in WA just a couple of weeks ago. He seems to have brought that form here straight from the get-go.
Yes, and I suppose winning the Australian singles a long, long time ago, he's certainly been a a very good player for a lot of years. The only thing I find a little bit funny, you don't see too many husband and wives playing mixed pairs, mate, because it doesn't usually turn out too well.
It would make for an interesting dynamic around the kitchen table and on the drive home if you get beat.
That's for sure.
Yeah, you'd have to have kind of a very special relationship, wouldn't you? So I know if my fiance was involved in bowls, I wouldn't play bowls with her.
No, there'd be some arguments, that's for sure.
I know if I played bowls with my wife would be the skip.
But they've played together for a lot of years, so it's not something they've sort of broken up over. So, and she's very competent in her own right, plays region bowls and had state trials before, so Julie's no slouch in the game either. So.
And a regular at state champions week and events like that, and inevitably going deep into pretty much anything she can test, including this event. She's a Victorian Open champion as well. She won the triples here a couple of years ago.
That's
too.
Correct.
With
yep.
Paddy Payne and Marty Chisholm. Probably going back 2 years now,
yeah,
I think.
I'm not 2 years
quite,
now, yes.
Yeah, it'd be 2014.
Now, Julie Ross was just pretty much trying to cover the trail of Sims there, I believe. She may have put maybe a little bit too much on it. She's sitting right on the ditch line. Don't know if the jack would go to that location, but pretty much where Sharon Steele is standing is where I think that Sims is going to try and push that bowl through. Ross, sorry. So now Michael's pretty much got a... little bit confused here, Mark, as to what he's trying to do.
Well, after that first bowl, I'm a little bit the same. But I think he's really just got to try and get as close as he can. You know, Ross's combination are right in the box seat here. They've got the tee covered. They've got the arresting touch and nilly. So sometimes you just got to, as I say, take your medicine, be one down, and try and get as close as he can and get on with the next end.
So I thought that he was trying to maybe cover with his first, because he's got three bowls, and then attack with his next, but his first went in the ditch.
Yeah, I think he was just a bit overweight on the draw, yep. What he was trying to do, and that his second bowl certainly corrected to give him second shot now. So.
Mark, one thing about Michael is we know he's playing his pennant bowls now for Melbourne this year, which is a new initiative. Explain to us how that came about. Obviously, there's competition in Tasmania, but he's decided to come here and play.
I think it was born out of when the Victorians played Tassie, and a lot of the Victorians were very impressed with the type of player that he was, and he's now skipping for Tasmania, and. A few of them asked him whether he'd be interested in coming as a fly-in marquee player for the Premier League, and he said, yeah, I'd love to. He knows it's a good, strong competition, and so he thought, I'll give it 12 months and see how it goes. So, and he's certainly finding it very challenging, and because you know, 1 week you'll play Nick McIntyre, who won the last one, and then you'll play Dane McKinnon the next week. So the actual competition's really tough, if he's going to get somewhere, he's got to play in that tough competition. So
that's exactly right. I mean, a competition basically will help you lift your own game, particularly when you're a young bowler.
So Ian just needs to do exactly what he did last time. Nice draw, get inside his own. And it's Looking not bad. Just needs to creep up a bit. It's a little bit short. So two shots. Bit of a lead, 5-1.
You know, they've got away to a good start, the two Rosses, so it's going to be Sharon and Michael trying to peg that back now, because once you get too far in front, on this sort of carpet, it's not easy to peg back.
We haven't seen too much of that at all on the show rink over the past 2 days. Teams just getting a run going away. This is probably the first time we've seen this. So interesting to see here how Sharon and Michael fight back.
Well, they certainly got to get on the board in the next couple of ends again. So otherwise, the game starts slipping away a little bit.
Reminder to everyone, 15 ends pulls us up here.
And Michael hasn't quite found it yet. Like it's been four ends. It's only been four ends, but he just hasn't quite found the line yet, I don't think. It makes it hard when you don't find it and your opposition's on it straight away. Puts you under pressure.
Yes, you start second-guessing yourself a little bit on what shot to play and what sort of weight you need to play. And I think he's just got to get back to the draw, and once he finds his draw again, then he'll start playing all the variants of the shots that he needs.
So three bowls, just a little bit through the head. Let's see if Steele can dob it on. Just through again. At least they're not short.
You can always use bowls that are behind the head, that's for sure. This is a better start by Sharon too. At least having bowls behind gives Michael a chance to play to a winning position. Three bowl pairs is virtually a skipper's game, as we call it in the game's all about the art of correction and giving the skip three bowls to play. Usually they do something with at least two out of the three, and if the lead can get on, it makes Michael's job with three bowls a lot easier.
Yeah, it's a conversion game, three bowl pairs. As we saw in the men's triples, Dane McKinnon and Nick McIntyre, the damage they do with two bowls, can't imagine what they'll do with three.
And Dane's probably last four or five ends, he just didn't quite get the right results on the conversions, whereas Nick got his conversions really good. So
we have Mike still dropping it short. Going to be the closest one. Let's see if Sims can correct from his last. Ross has got a better bowl here. It's definitely only one now.
As we said, that's why they give him three.
If you make contact with that bowl, the jack can spring out. And Sims and Steele have got a three shots out there. It's a little bit hard to see on the camera the shot bowl, how it is with the jack, but there you go. If you play a little bit narrower. So one shot to Ross, extends their lead 6-1.
They're getting a nice little gap, aren't they, at this stage of the match. And as we were talking about, you can't afford to let them get too far away on the carpet.
I think the same in the triples this morning. You know, they're only getting in ones, but they got that four or five break, and then you start looking for numbers, and if you don't get it, then, you know, you go further behind. So
sometimes it becomes like that for the opposition. It's death by a thousand cuts, isn't it?
That's exactly right.
Just a reminder, we're giving away three sets of Aero bowls. Tweet us your thoughts. We want you to be part of our live stream, not just watching it. You can win something too. Our hashtag 2016 Vic Open. And Russell Locke there. Well done to Gus Guy. That's Graham's nickname. Gus Guy, another boy in blue leading a team to victory in the trips. Good on you, Russell. Russell, a very good local bowler.
Yeah, he plays for Kyabram. I think he made it through to the final 16 in the men's singles. He's done a lot of in the GV. He's won plenty of GV titles and club championships. He's very high up there in the bowls.
Good to see you on Twitter, Russell. Best three tweets that we received today, as judged by our panel, will receive a set of Aero bowls. Our thanks to our friends at Aero. $500 worth each set. Great to have Aero as a part of our coverage of the 2016 Vic Open, brought to you by Greater Shepparton. We're at the Shepparton Park Bowls Club undercover on the show rink for the mixed pairs final.
The closest bowl, it's five ends have been down, but it just doesn't seem like anyone's really started to nail it just yet. Ian Ross has done a few good conversions and has been probably the best bowler at the moment, but no one's actually found that groove and bowled consistently good just yet. Might take a few more ends. What about the pressure, Mark, that Michael Sims has gone through? He's an elite bowler at this stage and only a young age. Do you think this will be affecting him a little bit playing on the show rink?
Oh no, I wouldn't have thought so. Michael's played a lot of the state series now against Victoria and New South Wales and these sort of things, so he's used to playing against the better players, and that's I certainly don't think Michael will be too worried about playing on the show rink.
All right. On the spot time for Mark Cowan. David Genford, put the pressure on Mark Cowan. Which of the Sims brothers will turn out to be the better player? No fence sitting. Hashtag ouch. Good luck with this one.
Thanks very much, David. I'll see you in a few weeks to tell you that. But there's a lot of people down in Tasmania says Michael's younger brother Lockie's just as good or even going to be better, but they're both very, very good, talented bowlers, and I've been a Michael fan for a long time. So I'm going to stick with Michael at this stage, but happy to prove wrong with Lockie down the track.
Well, Tasmania is very lucky to have two bowlers of their quality.
Yeah, all in the same family. So
absolutely.
Well,
We know there's plenty of people watching from Tasmania. Here we've got a lot of tweets and a lot of emails and texts and the like from folks in Tassie. They're very excited about Michael being in a final. Also Lee Schrainer, who's coming up in two finals later today. We will be televising the men's singles final, and that will be Lee Schrainer versus Matthew Flapper. So for our Tasmanian friends, we'd love you to stick around and catch it all day. Stick around with Michael, but at 6 p.m, your boy Lee Schrainer from Rosny Park in Hobart playing Matt Flapper.
He was on target then. Wasn't a bad bowl. He was a little bit unlucky.
Yeah, no, he's certainly got at least two there at the moment. So the last bowl, he's starting to get the hang of the pace a little bit.
Wasn't too far away then. Still, it's kind of a weird head this is set up. They're all kind of scattered around it, but they're not too close and they're kind of in the way.
Well, it's funny, the rink's been moved over half a rink from this morning, and whether or not one side's just a little bit different been worn compared to the side that hasn't been played on this morning, I'm not quite sure.
Ian's coming down, he's running after this one.
So this is the time, Michael's what we keep working on in the squad, about adding with your last rather than just saying, being content with the two shots he's got. Hopefully you can put the muscle memory into being and do exactly the same as what he did with his previous bowl and add to the count.
Yeah, he needs it this end to get back into things. Maybe change the length, we don't know. But Michael Sims needs to sit on that bowl.
Pretty happy with that.
That's good.
That'll give him a lot of confidence going forward.
So one out, two out, three out. This could be big. Get him right back into the game. Four out. From here, I didn't even see four shots there. I thought it was only three.
And I'm nearly liking the fifth too.
This could be a big, big change. So five shots. And
in one foul swoop, it's all back to tie. It's six all again.
Guy, you know what I'm going to say.
I know what you're going to say. Daniel, would you believe six all at the sixth end for, if I'm getting this right, the sixth successive show match. I'm really scared. This is spooky, ladies and gentlemen. The sixth successive show match we've had this.
Yeah.
That is amazing. And didn't look like it at the start or the end either. So.
Yeah, this game didn't even look like it was going to be a 6-6, did it? It was 6-1. The Rosses started to sort of have the way of things, and then all of a sudden, Sims and Steele pick up five.
It's one of the great things about our great sport. You are never out of it until the game's over, and you know you can, you know, picking up a five, that's a big number. When you're 6-1 down, gee, that's handy.
Wouldn't be surprised if they start nailing them now. We're on to N7. Yep, here we go.
Yeah, you can see the confidence straight away, can't you, by putting a close one first up.
What does that do for you, Mark? I mean, that just puts some oxygen. That pumps your tyres up, doesn't it?
Well, it certainly does. It's back to even, and you think, well, gee, if I haven't been playing all that well, but if I've picked up a five, I can now go on and really nail a jack. Certainly puts them in a better position.
We haven't seen too many big numbers at the business end of this tournament either.
No, we haven't. You know, the odd three, but to get five on the carpet being so even, that is a big number to get.
See if she can. Let's just see how her memory is here. She's put one pretty close. Next one's a bit behind. Not too bad though. Now Julie Ross just running a little bit through. It'll be second shot. She can correct from that.
I don't think it'll rattle Ian Ross too much. He knows they've been playing pretty good, so he'll just keep going doing the business that he's trying to do. So
plenty of room to draw here. So Wade's looking pretty good. Yep, Michael Sims, good ball. More like him. I was going to do a little pun then, but I thought I'd better not. It's more like Sim.
But you did.
Yeah.
No, it's gold. It's certainly enjoyable as well, isn't it? It's good to watch. This great standard of bowls that we're seeing right throughout the business end of this tournament. It's fun, and I think it lifts us all, including us commentating it. It's great to commentate on high standard bowls.
Yeah, this is good too. I reckon Michael's got a little bit on here. He can play a few shots, and Ian Ross really needs another one in the head. There's only one bowl there. Gee, that was a risky shot, wasn't it?
No, you'll never die wondering with Ian Ross, mate. He'll play the shot if it's there, regardless of whether it's dangerous or not for him. And unfortunately, he had a killed. He probably would have gone back to the spot and held two or three. But Michael's bowl's gone right out to the wing, to the boundary pegs, and holding shot. So he's got a chance of 5 or 6 feet to draw another now.
Now we'll just stick with the crowd shot here. We're just looking at the crowd, just on the left, second on the left there, of Roanna Smith, who will be playing. Is Roanna there, just on the left of screen?
Yeah, Loreen's...
Loreen's daughter. She'll be playing in the women's pairs final a little bit later on with Mum. And there's Loreen right next to her. So and there they are.
And it is fantastic. You don't get to play with your family too much in a sport because of the type of sports that are around. But bowls is a sport where you can play within your family, and there's nothing better than, play with my daughter and... same sort of thing. It's just fantastic to play, with the age difference, to play a sport with your family. So,
it is great. It is one of the great things about our sport. And your daughter Elise, obviously a state player herself, and that must be a great thing. You play at club level every week.
Let's talk about what's just happened here. Sorry, Mark, but Ross only had one bowl in the head, and there was 5 seconds there. Take his bowl out, he's 5 down. Instead, he's put the jack in the ditch, and Sims has gone up there. Then Sims has drawn another one, he's 2, and he's had a drive. Was he trying to get both bowls out?
I think he was, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, that's what he was trying to do. He's trying to get both bowls because they were reasonably close to each other, but when they're, only go over a foot apart, the angles of the bowls, it's very difficult to get both bowls out. So, whether it was the percentage play, he saw it that way, but... maybe trying to draw a second shot might have been a better option.
So we've played 7 ends, and we've already seen how aggressive, and even the shots that Ian Ross is playing, they could come across a little bit risky. But like Mark just said, he's not going to go down, is he? He's just going to chuck it down and see what happens.
Yes, he doesn't ponder too much around the head about what shot to play. He sees the shot from the mat end and he just plays it, and he'll back himself every time.
I've never seen the gentleman play before, so it's all new to me.
there's been a few shots there where I've just been like, oh, he's just going to draw that, he's going to do that, and he's just gone straight up and done it.
Yeah, we all see it differently, that's for sure.
Great start.